Whether you're here today by obligation or courtesy or accidentally or very intentionally, I believe today what I have to say applies to every one of us. Because I believe it's coming out of the Word of God. And so there you go. So after this, it's all on Him. So the last words, as again, as we've spoken here, this was a continuous letter, but in chapter 4, basically the last words I mentioned a few weeks ago. If a man knows what is right and fails to do it, if a man knows what is right and fails to do it, that for him is sin. Why wouldn't we do what's right? It's been a theological question through time of what sin is. Well, I think James makes it pretty simple for us, even though we know it's not simple. It's complex because we are complex. But I love the Maya Angelou that I shared with you a few weeks ago, the quote, "Do the best you can until you know better." Now, again, I know this could go across everything if you're not even a Christian. But do the best you can until you know better. Then when you know better, do better. I've actually been challenged on that before, which really surprised me. Preached it from this pulpit, you know, 6 or 7 years ago, and somebody got stuck on that. They just couldn't go with it. And I thought, okay, we probably are not going to be on the same page on a lot of things, and there's a good chance of that. But that's okay. So here James jumps into James, or we're going to jump in what we would call chapter 5. So there's a little bit of shift here, and I'm just working through it again. Even this morning, I thought I was where I was going to be, then I took out a chunk of it, and you don't even know what that chunk is, but the reality is, I think it's another partly message, okay? Because there's so much in this. There's so much in the book of James that I think, as we wrestle through it, to think, as Dr. Dan said last week, it almost was taken out. Almost was left out of the canon, almost left out of the scripture for us to wrestle with, to imagine that. And as we go through chapter 5, we will see why part of it, people really wrestle with it, especially as you get to the end of chapter 5. And there's a few things that I won't spend a lot of time on in chapter 5 that I think does have bearing on this, and I'll just say them real quick. The second coming kind of is in chapter 5, kind of is weaved in throughout it because you can't almost miss it, because they felt that the second coming, in many ways, those Christians hearing that, it was now. James says near, okay. So that, we're not going to get into that, even though I want you to know that it's inside of it. You almost can't ignore it. The other thing is, he uses the word rain. I wish I could spend a whole message, and I may someday, on just rain in Scripture. What rain means in Scripture. But I don't know about you, but this is how I think of rain often, and I think of it when I and again, I don't know, it doesn't always, but it would apply today, because it rains on the who and who? The just and the unjust. Okay? But I don't know about you, but for me, one of my favorite things to do, and I get a chance to do it not as often as I wish, but especially be up in the mountains of Arizona in the monsoon season. And I'm not talking about destructive rain, okay? I'm not talking about what we just saw on the East Coast, and I hope you're praying for them. I'm not talking about 30 inches in 12 hours or whatever the numbers were. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about that rain where you're sitting on a porch and it's just pouring. You hear the thunder a little bit in the background, but it's just this soothing, calming. I'm not going to talk about that either. But I wish I could. But we're going to dive into this, and as soon as I dive into it, you're going to go, man, I wish you'd be talking about rain. So here we go. John chapter 5, verse 1. Now listen, you rich people. Weep and wail because of the misery that is coming on you. We just stop there and go home, right? Just that's it. That's all we need to know. It's coming. It's whew. Your wealth has rotted and moths have eaten your clothes. Your gold and silver are corroded. The corrosion will testify against you and eat your flesh like fire. Now, this is so encouraging. You have hoarded wealth in the last days. Now, again, the second gets all kind of over the top of this. Look, the wages you failed to pay the workers who mowed your fields are crying out against you. The cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord Almighty. You have lived on earth in luxury and self-indulgence. You have fattened yourselves on the day of slaughter. You have condemned and murdered the innocent one who is not opposing you. In other words, for no reason. And we'll get back into that a little bit. Be patient then, brothers and sisters, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop, patiently waiting for the autumn and spring rains. You too, be patient and stand firm, because the Lord's coming is near. Don't grumble against one another, brothers and sisters, or you will be judged. The judge is standing at the door, the capital J there, okay? Brothers and sisters, as an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. As you know, we count as blessed those who have persevered. You have heard of Job's perseverance and have seen what the Lord finally brought about. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. See, I want you to, of all that's said here, the Lord is full of compassion and mercy. Okay, in the middle of all this, don't miss that. Above all, my brothers and sisters, do not swear, not by heaven or earth or anything else. All you need to say is a simple yes or no, otherwise you will be condemned. That's another message. So briefly, I want to talk about the first part of this. I think all this comes together, and the reason why we have to tie it together, because I'm going to jump to verse 7, and I'm going to back my way back in, because there's a word, and it's not up on the screen, but he says, be patient then. It's the word then. So if he says that, then we got to go, okay, what's he saying we need to be patient about? So we got to go back. So I could have just jumped in at be patient, right? We could talk about patience and suffering and those kind of things, but if we don't know what then means, then we misunderstand the other part. And the way that James is speaking here, the best I can understand, is that he's not writing this letter to rich people. For the most part, he's speaking to mostly poor people. There's a great chance. That doesn't mean there's not business people in there that have money. But for the most part, his audience is that. So most likely, rich people are not even going to get this letter. So he's not even speaking directly to them. Basically, what he's doing is, it's a form of speech where for a minute you get to eavesdrop as if he's speaking to someone else and you get to listen in. So he's speaking as if he's speaking to rich people, and the poor people get to listen in on the conversation, even though the rich people are not there. And part of the purpose of that is, and we'll see it, is don't be envious of this. Don't be envious of what you see over there. But I also want to make sure we understand what I don't believe James is saying, wealth in itself is a wrong thing. It is what you do with it and what it does to you. Because the corrosiveness, literally it means poison. That's what it means. Corrosiveness. He said this corrosiveness, and we can see that Jesus said, don't lay up things that are what? Temporal. Where moths and all, those who know Scripture know Jesus. James, what I love about James is he's like he listened to his brother. He was paying attention. Because you hear Jesus' words and examples, even like the farmer. He's using a parable. He's using something. And again, I don't want to jump too far ahead. But he's using something those people know about. Jesus did it all the time. James is doing the same thing, except he's that brother that goes, okay, good cop, bad cop. But Jesus is sometimes bad cop too. But anyway, James is never good cop, okay? James almost never good cop. But anyway, even though, and I said to you a few weeks ago, there really is good news in the middle of all of James. Extremely good news. But what he's trying to get at. But the main thing he is addressing here, and what he's saying is that the corrosiveness of this, even unintentionally, poisons our judgment. We may not even know it's happening. And before, it's the reason why we got to have accountability around us. And that's the reason why even as Christians, poor or rich and everything in between, need to have accountability. Because it's easy to get lost in either one of them. But what he's pointing at here is basically three things I want to point out, and we won't go deep dive into it necessarily. But he says, is hoarding, extravagance or self-indulgence, extravagance, and injustice. There's really the kind of the three things he's harping on here. The hoarding of it, or the getting more of it than you need, keeping more of it than you should. And I don't mean that person hasn't earned it, but you've earned it for a purpose. God's blessed you for a purpose. It was not to hoard. Because he goes into the injustice part of it. You didn't get blessed for this to hoard it. Or, and scripture says, or to get fat on it. Literally is what he says. You didn't get it for that reason. And he says, so when you look over there and see people with that, realize that there's a poison attached to it when it's based on those reasons. There's a corrosion attached to that way of thinking. Not wealth in itself. Don't hear what I'm not saying. But you're jealous of that, but look the corrosive, the poison that's attached to it. Sometimes, often, unintentionally, they don't know it. Don't be envious. Now, again, of course, he's saying here, and I'm still jumping ahead a little bit. They're thinking Jesus is coming back next week. Okay, that's the way he's saying. Just be patient because Jesus is coming back pretty quick. That's kind of what they're thinking. Anyway, he hasn't yet. But I will say what he's saying is, just on second coming and I'll get out of it. I do think what he's saying, and we see where we are today, there's nothing standing in the way of him coming right now. That would be a better way to say it. Whether he comes right now or not, that's a whole different issue. But there's nothing standing in the way that would keep him from coming right now that we can see. That's a better way to clarify that, I think. And he goes on to say, he's talking about the workers. Now I thought it was interesting. I had never thought about this, but and you know they're speaking to those workers in Palestine because I'd never thought about this, but the Palestine, it was only in Palestine would the field laborers be hired for help. In other words, they'd get paid. Everywhere else in the Roman Empire, they were slaves. So it's the only specific place he even could be speaking. It's again, he's speaking contextually, right? He's speaking to, because if he's speaking to slaves, they don't know, what do you mean I'm going to get money? I don't even know what you're talking about. How are they keeping money from me? Because I don't get money. So he's speaking to a certain crowd. Then he speaks about the rains, right? Rains twice a year or two seasons. You know when they come. But he's saying, even in your labors, you cheat your workers. You have all this and you still do this. And they don't have it. They're not even opposing you. They're not even pushing back on you. And you still do it. As if you're murdering them. Now again, could they be murdering them? Sure. But I don't think it's what James is saying. You're taking away their dignity. You're taking away things from them. You're taking away all this purpose in life. You're pushing them down because you can. Because somewhere along the way, the riches corroded. Somewhere along the way, the riches made you believe it was your right. that it was just. Because one of the huge advantages, he said, and he talks about what, let me see, yeah. So one of them says taking them to court. In one version it says you take them to court. Now, you think the world we live in, most of the time, the one reason the poor people don't sue the rich people because they can't afford it, right? They can't do that. And so not much changed over all these years in that sense. But you know, I was looking at this, Jan and I, we've done different businesses and different things over the years. And you know, you do think sometimes, what is enough? When you're selling a house, and we've flipped enough houses, how much profit is enough? And I don't know the answer to that. I'm going to confess to you. I don't really know the answer to that. We had a four-point strategy in flipping houses, and I won't go into all that right now, but we did, and I think we did it to try to keep us on track and try to be as honorable as we knew how. But we've been in a situation before where we've got a bidding war on a house, and we almost felt sick to our stomach that we made more money than we intended to. And that sounds kind of like, how can you do that? But it was weird. Because you get 12 offers, and all of them have a story attached to it, and all of a sudden you almost feel like God there, that you're, it is a weird, I don't know the answer to all this. I don't know how much is enough to make on gasoline or food, or I don't know all that. But what I do know is that the extravagance of all this is what James is really challenging here. And I thought this was interesting as a quote, and I'm not saying go live by it, because I don't think I do right now. Well, maybe I do, but it says, we should never be living as well as we could. Well, that's an interesting statement. I'm not saying I'm going to live by it. I'm just saying it's an interesting statement. I'm just confessing to you. I wish I could. I'm not going to live as good as I could, because I'm going to use the riches I have for the injustices around me. You know, I was thinking, if John Wesley was in America today, not even Jesus, which is a whole different conversation. Let's just take somebody more recent in the sense of walking the face of the earth. Would you agree with him politically? You don't know. If he was political, I'm not saying he would be political. Don't hear that. But I'm going to tell you, one of the things Wesley would have challenged, materialism being one of them, but injustice. How often does that come on your radar each week? What's unjust around me that I could do something about? And you go, well, I'm retired now. I really don't have to fight that. John Wesley was 69 years old, equivalent to 140 years old, our age, because he, at that time people were dying in their 40s. That's the truth. He lived way beyond what he should have. Not should have, that was God's call. But what normal people lived then. He was 69 years old when he started fighting slavery. 69 years old, spent the next 18 years of his life fighting slavery and abolished it. Wilberforce, mentor, a mentee. Okay, that's what he did. He didn't retire. He took on the biggest thing of his age at 69 years old. What's the biggest injustice? I don't know the answer to all that. I'm not going to tell you. I know where Wesley would land or if he would even deal with it at all. But what I will say is this. You might not like the answer if you talk to him. You might not. Because I'm going to tell you, he's going to ask, who's treating the poor the best? Who's mistreating the poor the worst? I can guarantee he'd ask that. Because I think it's what Jesus would ask. William Booth, the Salvation Army coming out of the Wesleyan tradition, when they would pick them up in the street and lift their heads and talk about, you were made with more dignity than this, God. They saw the image of God in those people laying in the streets. The question is not wealth here, in my opinion, when I read this. The question is what you do with it. But then he flips it around to the poor. And he goes, you know what? Just because you're poor, you don't get to grumble and complain. Woe is me. Now, I know he didn't say woe in there, but I think I can read it in there. He said, be patient. Like a farmer planting seeds. The rain comes at the seasons. And you know it. And they plant it with patience, and they plant it with hope, and they put it in the ground, not knowing for sure, except God will return a harvest. Then he basically says, and by the way, when you plant the seed, there's still work to do in between here. You don't get to set back and just wait. God will do it. If God's going to do it, he'll do it. No, he needs you in the field. He needs you doing the things in between. But when we talk about patience, it's so easy for us, especially when he's talking about the poor here, to be envious, and it's what he's addressing mainly here, and I've already, referred to that earlier in the message. It's going, you're sitting here so envious of those. How did they get that, if you will? And especially when it comes to suffering. He literally says, you will suffer in this. In your suffering, you need to be patient. And going, wait a second, they look like they're the fattened calf, right? They get to live high on the hog. And I've got to suffer? He uses the term stand firm. The Apostle Paul uses that over and over, especially in Ephesians 6, to stand. Continue to stand. Stand in the warfare. Stand. But one of the things that James is, I think, very obvious about here is that you find out Christians who suffer, they're not blazing a new trail. It's a well-worn path of Christians. Matter of fact, suffering, as I read this, suffering is not the sign of things that have gone wrong, but they've gone normal. A few years ago, matter of fact, 26 years ago, more than a few, I did my first hike here in Arizona. I went with the guys, teenagers, and one guy about my age. We went to Flatiron. Now I'm an experienced hiker today. I would not choose that as a first hike for someone who's never hiked before, okay? Just so you know, those who know that Superstition Mountains, Flatiron sticking out there, it's about an elevation about 3,000 feet. And about 5-6 miles, different versions you read how far it is. But it's a good ways, and it's a scramble. And you get in the siphon draw, and you get in the middle of that draw, and you have to start scrambling a little bit. And a matter of fact, those who've done it, Ed, and different ones, you can get lost on it. If you're not locked in, you end up way over here off the trail, and you're messed up, and you keep seeing it up there, and you're just way off of it, and that's what was happening to us. And so, again, it's my first hike ever, and we're in that draw, and we're going up and climbing, and we got to a point, and we just all looked at each other and go, this ain't worth it. We were exhausted and just going, what? And this is my first hike ever, and Arkansas, we just call it walking, but here it was hiking, okay? And so there I am going, what are we doing? We're going back down. And we hear these voices up above us, and I'm not talking about heaven. We just hear these voices from above. And they're getting closer, getting closer. And all of a sudden, we see this group of about 10 people that are probably 60, 70 years old coming down the mountain. And I looked at our guys going, we're going up this mountain. We are going up this mountain. And we talked to them. They said, oh, yeah, it's just up here. We were just almost to the top. We didn't know it, though. We'd never been there. We're suffering. We're trying to persevere, but we're about to give up. But here comes this group of people who are experienced, who have been up and down that path many times. And they just say to you, man, keep going. It's not very far, but keep going. You're going to be okay. You know why we need community? You know why we need church? You know why you need to be in a church where you can be connected to people? Because they'll say, I've been on this path a long time. And you jump from church to church, you may not ever find that. But I've been on this path a long time. I've walked this out. I can point some out in here who walked a path of faithfulness and suffering and patience and say, you're going to be okay. You're going to be okay. In America, we've created this gospel. Is that Jesus is in this for your comfort, for your sake. And Jesus would never let that happen to you. We've got people in here who've lost children. Tragically, they keep walking. I say, you can do this. When we start thinking we're going to graduate people out of here because they're not needed anymore, because they're older, and they just, oh, my goodness. They're the ones coming down from Flatiron. Come on, folks. When you want to give up, you may hear those voices. And you go, I can keep going. But you may not hear it if you're not in a group of people that's mixed intergenerationally. I'll just throw that plug in. You may not get to hear that. We don't execute everything we believe in here well, but there are some things we really believe in that I know are right. And when we do execute it, it's right. Most of the time. But one of them is intergenerational. Not just multi-generational, but intergenerational. If you ain't dead, you're not done. Matthew chapter 11. Jesus confronts this. I'm going to read this scripture because it's one that many of you know I've preached on a decade or two ago, and it's not mostly mine. It's Irv McManus, and I don't have any problem giving him credit for it. And he wrote a book called The Barbarian Way. But he uses this example, and I think it might help us today as we close this out, understanding that one, let me again say, it's not wealth in itself that James is speaking to. It's the poison that can be attached to it. But let me say this, just back up just a second as I get into Matthew 11. Marxism or capitalism, progressive or conservative, the sinfulness of a man's heart can make any of those corrupt. You can throw the flag up either place, but it's what's in a man and a woman's heart. And justice. And I can't preach a gospel, and Dan's going to even help us even more, that just says that God's only in this for your comfort and your joy. I can't preach that. But as Jesus' words, or Jesus is approached here, and it's John the Baptist, and John the Baptist is about to have his head cut off. So when Jesus had finished giving these instructions to his 12 disciples, he went out to teach and preach in towns throughout the region. John the Baptist, who was in prison, again, he's about to get his head cut off. John the Baptist was in prison. Heard about all these things the Messiah was doing, so he sent to his disciples to ask Jesus, are you the Messiah we've been expecting, or should we keep looking for someone else? You're his cousin. Why are you asking this? You're the one that said, there he is. Why are you asking this? Jesus told them, back to the disciples, go back to John and tell them what you have heard and seen. The blind see, the lame walk. Those who have leprosy are cured. The deaf hear. The dead are raised to life. And the good news, the good news, the good news is being preached to the wealthy. No, it doesn't say that. It says it's being preached to the poor. And he added, God blesses those who do not fall away because of me. As John's disciples were leaving, Jesus began talking about him to the crowds, about John. What kind of man do you go into the wilderness to see? Was he a weak reed swayed by every breath of wind? Or were you expecting to see a man dressed in expensive clothes? Matter of fact, John Baptist wouldn't even be welcome in our church, just so you know, because he'd be too, we'd be calling security. Anyway. No. People with expensive clothes lived in palaces. Were you looking for a prophet? Yes, and he is more than a prophet. John is the man to whom the scripture refers to when they say, look, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, and he will prepare your way before you. I tell you the truth. All who have ever lived, none is greater than John the Baptist. Yet even the least person in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. I love that line. Even you are as great as him in this sense. And from the time John the Baptist began preaching and until now, the kingdom of heaven has been forcefully advancing, and violent people are attacking it. You will suffer. John, about to get his head cut off. He just wants to be sure. He's your cousin. You said, look, there is the one. But when it came time, he just wanted to be sure. The lame walk, the blind see. The good news is preached to the poor. But blessed is the man, blessed is the woman, blessed is the child who does not fall away because they follow after me. Yes, John, I'm going to let them cut your head off. Yes, John, I am. That flies in the face of a gospel that's preached so often. That Jesus is here for my security. He's here for my benefit. He would never let that happen to me. I don't see that anywhere in Scripture. I hear him saying, be patient. I'm hearing him saying, there will be suffering. But there will be reward. That doesn't mean all of it's got to be suffering. You know what I'm saying. There's joy. There's all kinds. But to say somehow another. That I'm not one of his because I suffer. Matter of fact, it says things are normal. You don't go out asking for it. I don't pray for suffering. I hope you don't. But the reality is, if we're not careful, you know, I love what Bergman Manis says. He says, we teach the saying, the safest place is to be in the center of God's will. He said, bumper stickers, refrigerator magnets, and a Christian book in Christian bookstore and all that. And we all know that once it makes it to the Christian bookstore, it's biblical. He said, it's so comforting, so reassuring, so unbiblical. Where do we get the idea that the safest place is to be in the center of God's will? Because he says, remember, I don't have it written here, but I remember him saying, he said, being out of God's will is dangerous, being in the center of God's will is dangerous, but being in the center of God's will makes you dangerous. That's the difference. And if we're going to raise up a generation that all we want them to do is know about God but not experience God, we're in trouble. I can teach you all day long to know about God. I think one of the reasons Jan and I know, the first time we ever saw Brother Paul in Arkansas, he just got back and he smelled really bad because he had to get on the ground to pick up a drunk that was so inebriated, had urine all over him and everything, and it picked him up. This Paul Sr., those who know the difference, picked him up and had to put him in his car and carry him to the hospital. And I remember some of those guys saying to me, to us, going, Slim specifically would say, he said, he's the only guy to get down on the ground with us and look us eye to eye. What are you doing for the poor? What injustice are you fighting? Don't grumble because you suffer, because it's part of it. Doesn't mean you can't pray for it to go away. Doesn't mean you can't pray for healing. Doesn't mean you can't ask for those things. You ask not. You know, you get not because you ask not, because you ask from the wrong motive. You can ask for the right motive and pray, Lord's will be done. I think we can stack all that up inside of James. But man alive, this faith that James is talking about, it is not about comfort. As I read James, I think the biggest confession I have to you is about my own life is I got a long ways to go. I've come a long ways. But man, I've got a long ways to go. And what drives me, I ain't going to be tending no grave. I ain't going to do that. I ain't going to spend the rest of my life just trying to figure out how to get out of this thing. What I'm going to try to do is drag as many people with me where I believe I'm going. And part of that is helping them believe that they're made for more. Made for more. But we have to get in the ugliness and the messiness because people suffer by their own doing. They suffer by other people's doing. They suffer because they're just a human being living on this earth. And the best way I can do that is be the healthiest version of me I can possibly be. So that's what we're trying to do. I appreciate James. I like to be coached. James is a coach going, yeah, we're good here, but we ain't as good as we could be. And there's a way to get there. And there's a way to get there, right? Amen. Would you stand with me? We're going to, Josiah, let's go come sing our way out of here. Okay? Let's do Made for More. And I love all of them. I love talking about the rain this morning. Rain down on us, rain down on us. If I'd had that sermon ready this morning, we'd sing it right now, okay? But yeah. A lot of times we all suffer in some ways, and patience, what God asked me to be patient on, He may not ask you to be patient on. What I suffer through and what I would classify as suffering, you may not ever experience. And what you suffer through, I have no clue. The one thing I can have is compassion and empathy and go, okay, I don't know what you're going through. I don't really know. I've never experienced that. But I've experienced suffering. That, if you can go, well, I don't ever have that, then I want to say I hate it for you. Because you don't get a chance to persevere. And perseverance builds what? Character. And our whole goal here is to be more like Jesus. So if you don't suffer a little bit, sometimes a lot, then you don't have the option to persevere. And if you don't have the option to persevere, how are you going to become like Jesus? I don't know. Let me pray for us. We're going to sing out of here on an up note, this song, and I hope it's an anthem as much as it is anything, and a reminder. God is a God, and I read it in here this morning, of mercy and compassion. And He wants to be He wants us to be an extension of that. Amen. Lord, thank You today for Your word. For Your word, Lord. Again, as I said earlier, I hope I spoke it and didn't take anything and take somebody down a path in the way that I spoke it this morning that is detrimental to their faith. Lord, so I pray that You would take that. Use Your spirit to not let that happen. Check my spirit if I did. And I can fix it if I can. But Lord, outside of that, I pray for each person here that the word that is spoken today lands exactly where it needs to land. As I confess, Lord, as I've been preaching this over this last many weeks, it is a huge reminder to me I ain't near where I need to be. But I'm not close to where I used to be because of Your mercy and grace. Lord, keep working on us. Keep helping us. And Lord, we don't want to just know about You. We want to experience walking with You. And often those are painful. So I pray for those today who may have come and they're in that window right now of pain and suffering, and it's very apparent. Lord, I hope they hear the voices up above, or they'll walk across the room today to someone and say, I see you coming here every week, and I don't want to guess your age and offend you, but I bet you've walked this further than I have. Can I just ask you something? How do you keep going up and down this mountain? And I believe they'll tell them because I know the trail. And it's well worn. Lord, help us today to be the people that when people walk in this room, they feel at home, but they also know this is a place, if I stay here long enough, I'll be different and more like Jesus because the people I'm with and what they're trying to accomplish. So Lord, help us today to be that. Lord, I pray that You'd let us sing this song as an anthem and as a hope because of what You can do and have done. We pray this in Your precious name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Sing with us before we go.